You can never arrive at the truth when you take a scripture out of context, no matter how many results you get from it. The truth of the matter is, it doesn't become true because you have a result. It doesn't become true because you have a result. Because some of the people that oppose me, their argument is, when we ask people to give and they give, they have testimonies. But let us think objectively. A pastor asks the church to give, God will multiply it. And only three people gave testimony out of 1,000. Is God partial? Is God partial? If it is true, if that principle is true, why is everybody in the church not having the testimony? So experience does not validate truth. It is true because it is true, irrespective of result or no result. Are we in the building? And many people, that's their argument. Just like if you go to a native doctor and they give you a charm, it works. But the fact that the charm works, does it make it the truth? No. You go to a soothsayer, a diviner, and they give you something and it works. The fact that it works, does it make it genuine? No. So it is not truth because you had result. It is only truth because it is truth. And remember, you can never get truth out of a lie. You can never get the truth out of a lie. Any scripture that is not rightly divided, once a preacher is preaching from a scripture that is not rightly divided, he is preaching a lie. He is preaching a lie. And it's easy to take any scripture out of context. For example, there's a scripture in Deuteronomy we were taught and we used to use it. The Lord God of my fathers make you 1,000 times more than you've ever been. Then when we quote that scripture, we'll ask you to sow a seed of 1,000 more. That is, it must be in thousands. Any money you're giving must be in thousands so that God can make you 1,000 more. Now that scripture, that's not what he's talking about. It was just a prayer of Moses for the children of Israel. His desire for them. It's not as a result of their giving. It's just the wish of a father over his people. Yet preachers have twisted that to a scripture for collecting thousands. Are you following now? So you can't get the truth out of a lie. You cannot get the truth out of a lie. Listen carefully. An experience does not validate a lie. If it is a lie, it's a lie. So we want to look at why we give. Acts 8, 9 to 11. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great man. So somebody deceived an entire city, a sorcerer, a native doctor, deceived a whole city, like Uyo, like Akwa Ibom, as a whole state. And everybody was looking up to him like he was a great man, but they didn't know that he was a sorcerer. He was a native doctor. He was a juju priest. They didn't know that he was a soothsayer, a diviner. They didn't know that all those things he uses as power, he gets them from necromancy, interfacing with the spirit of the dead spirits. You know, a particular man who got born again through my preaching told me he used to sleep in graveyards. He used to sleep in graveyard for months, seeking power, fasting in graveyard, alone in the night, seeking for power. Until he encountered my teaching. Then he discovered this is where the real power is. Things that people do. And the end, the intent is to collect money. The intent is for money. Are you understanding? The intent is for money. So this guy was a sorcerer, a native doctor, who was held a whole city spellbound. Look at verse 10. To whom they all gave heed. From the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. Everybody respected him. Next verse. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched the whole city with sorceries, with witchcraft. So people can be respected over time because of witchcraft, sorcery, necromancy, diabolical power, demonic hold. And today the pulpit is not exempted. There are a lot of them behind the pulpit wearing suit and tie, and they are operating with diabolical power. And the gullible audience don't know the difference because nobody has taught them the gospel. The only way you can know the difference between a man of God and a native doctor is through the preaching. When you are taught the word, when you are taught the message, the moment you have the soundness of the message, when you see a man of God, you will know. When you say diabolical man, you will know. The acid test is the word of God. The word of God. That's why I spend time teaching you and teaching you and teaching you, because we live in perilous times. And I don't want anybody under my spiritual oversight to be used for experiment. I don't want anybody under my tutelage to be used by charlatans for their personal gains. Look at verse 12 to 13. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. 13. Then Simon himself, the sorcerer, believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Verse 18. And when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay my hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. That is what today in the prosperity gospel they brand as, sow a seed to tap into grace. Sow a seed for a breakthrough. Your offering will remove your suffering. If you don't tithe, it will be tight. The heavier your sacrifice, the weightier your breakthrough. All that is fraud. This is the same thing the sorcerer did. The sorcerer came to Peter and said, I want the power. Here is a bag of money. I have brought seed. Give me the power. I want to tap. That's the same thing. And the reason why the sorcerer did it is because that is how they function in the kingdom of darkness. You give them something for them to give you something. White fowl, red fowl, lizard without legs. Why? Because it's a foul spirit you are about to contract. Then when you give them those things, they now give you something in exchange. So people now bring that native doctorism mentality unto God. If you don't give God, God cannot give you. Who told you? If you don't tithe, it will be tight. Who told you? Who told you? When scriptures are not properly divided, the Bible can be used to say anything you want to say. But when it is rightly divided, then you find the truth of the gospel. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast taught that the gift of God may be purchased with money. You don't buy grace. Any grace that can be bought is not grace. Grace means you can't buy it. Grace means you can't afford it. Grace means you don't deserve it. So therefore, since you don't qualify for it, somebody gave it to you for free. So you can't tap grace by money. Any grace you tap with money is fake grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus cannot be bought. Peter said, go and perish. You can't buy a miracle with money. The power of God is freely given. We don't buy it. And the reason why the sorcerer behaved like that is because he's used to doing it in his sorcery. Are we following here? He said, go and perish. You can't buy the grace of God with money. And some of us, that has been our mentality. Every time we need something from God, we have to look for something to give so that God can give us. And we have rubbished the character of God. Our God is not for sale. My Father is not in a transaction. When you have to give to God to get, that's a transaction. That is not giving. In generosity, you give expecting nothing. In generosity, you just give.